So in this video presentation, we're going to go back and look at the three-plate looping method and the connections in the ceiling rows, in the consumer units and one-way switches jug. So we've brought the camera in and we're looking at the consumer unit first. The circuit we've wired or mimicked is three batten lamp holders, one-way controlled by three switches. Can you just go through the connections for me, please? I see we're using a miniature RCBO, 6 amps, type B and rated at 30 milliamps.
This is just an ordinary 100 amp main switch. What we've then got here, the RCBO. Now you'll notice in the top of the RCBO, there's two connections, one for the line and one for the neutral. Remember, an RCD operates by monitoring the current flowing through the line and back down the neutral again. If that current is the same, then the RCD is happy. If it starts to see that there is less current in the neutral than there is in the line conductor, for example, it knows that current is leaking somewhere, either through an earth conductor or through a person, and it knows that it's time to trip. So you can see coming out the top there, there's our line connection, there's our neutral connection, and then right tucked at the back here, there's a neutral connection coming out, and that goes from the RCBO and onto the neutral bar.
We can also see there's an A-type RCD, and we've identified the circuits with number one on the line, neutral and circuit protective conductor for ease of installation and ease of identification during, say, fault finding or removal of circuits. We now know all domestic lighting circuits, regardless of how the wiring system has been installed, needs additional protection by an RCD rated at 30 milliamps or less. Can you just explain what we're trying to mimic here as a circuit?
Yeah, so what we're looking at here is this might be a typical domestic lighting circuit. Let's say it's the upstairs lighting on a domestic property. So what we've got, although the cable runs are a lot shorter than they would be in the real world, all of the connections and all of the principles remain exactly the same. So first of all, what we're doing is we're taking a 1 millimeter squared conductor, and that is coming from our consumer unit to our first lighting point. So let's call this bedroom one, okay? Within this conductor, we've got a line conductor and a neutral, and that comes up to here. Those are permanently live cables, so there's no switching taking place yet. From this point, we then continue with a permanent line and neutral to the light in bedroom two, and then to the light in, say, bedroom three. From each lighting point, we then drop down to the switch, and we drop down with a twin brown in this case. Now, it is possible to do this with a brown and blue conductor. However, that blue conductor must have some brown sleeving on it to indicate that it is a line conductor and not a neutral. So this picks up the permanent line from inside the light fitting. It goes down to the switch. The switch then makes or breaks the line conductor onto the switching line, which then comes back up and into the switch line terminal inside the light fitting. Therefore, this switch will then operate the lighting circuit.
If we look inside the back of the ceiling rows where the batten lamp holder is connected, we can see this is our incoming cable Joe coming up to the first floor into light one, say in bedroom number one. So we're bringing in a neutral conductor and a permanent line conductor. The trick now is that the permanent line conductor, in this case from the consumer unit, goes in a terminal marked loop. Our neutral conductor goes in the terminals marked N. And then we've got to look at bringing a second cable down here, which is going to come down to our switch. This is the twin brown you discussed earlier. So the twin brown will take a permanent line out of loop and a returning switching line, which goes in L. Okay, it's a bit confusing. L is really a switching line conductor in order to turn on the light fitting itself. We can now see the lamp has connected to one side of it, a neutral, and the other side of it, a controlled switching line, allowing us from the one-way switch below to turn on and off the lighting point. In order to make the circuit safe, we have a circuit protective conductor connected in the terminal marked with a earth symbol where they're all housed together. So all the CPCs are in one terminal. This doesn't require a CPC as it's made of plastic, but could be later turned for an exposed conductive part, such as a metallic light fitting. The other neutral, the other line in the loop, and the other CPC is the continuation of a permanent line from loop, the neutral and circuit protective conductor on the outgoing cable. In this case, we're mimicking it going to another bedroom. So that would take a permanent line, a neutral and CPC, and we repeat the process of what we've done inside here. As we've previously discussed in the classroom, these type of Bayonet cap lamp holders have no polarity. So as we look at the two pins in there, it doesn't matter which one's connected to line and which one's connected to neutral. and we've discussed in the classroom about Edison screw and the polarity on those. So the cable is now dropped down from the ceiling rows above, and this is the twin brown and CPC cable that we discussed. So one of these conductors here of the twin brown will be in the common and bringing down the permanent line connection. And one of them will be the returning switching line conductor, which we're connecting in the L section of the batten lamp holder and ceiling rows. Remember that L is for really switching line. We've secured a CPC into the back of the box, again, because it's fully insulated. The CPC is not required, but is there in case we change it for an exposed conductive part. The cable size is 1 mm² for all conductors, including the CPC in this cable. The switch itself is a one gang one way. So as we look at it here on the other switch, we can see one gang for one switch on the front. And as we turn it over, we can see we've got a connection between common and L1, making it a one gang one way switch. I've moved across to lighting point two. We discussed just a moment ago this cable here bringing in our permanent line connection, which is connected in loop, our neutral connection connected into the neutral, and our CPC connected here with the other circuit protective conductors. Again, the conductors are all 1 mm², and we repeat the process again. So one of these brown conductors will be coming down to the switch. One of them will be coming back from the switch and connected in what's called L, but which is a switching line. And we repeat the process again going out with a neutral and permanent line. Remember, all those cables also have a circuit protective conductor, and the process repeats itself again. So we're at the last point on our lighting circuit, but I can see some subtle differences here. Can you tell me what's going on?
So here you can see we've brought our cable from the previous light fitting into this light fitting, but inside here you'll notice that we seem to be missing some conductors. Now the reason for this is we've technically reached the end of the circuit. So what's happened here, we've brought our permanent live in, and that's gone into the loop terminal. We've brought our neutral in, and that goes into the neutral terminal, but we're not wiring another light fitting off this one, and therefore there's no need to take another permanent line, neutral and CPC out of the circuit. The other key point that you may notice in here is this conductor here. So here we've got a blue conductor, so our brain would normally go, that's a neutral, but you'll notice that it's got some brown sleeving on it. Now that brown sleeving indicates that this, what would be classed as a neutral conductor, is actually acting as a line conductor now. So this is designed to act as a line. Now the reason for that, this is just to illustrate a point that it is both possible and permissible to use a brown and blue conductor as our switch drop running down to our switch here. However, if a brown and blue conductor is used, then it's very important that this blue conductor has brown sleeving over it to show anybody who comes back to this installation that this conductor is actually acting as a line conductor and not a neutral. So that brown sleeving is very, very important. Other than that, this cable is just acting purely like a twin brown. It's picking up the permanent line, it's taking it down to the switch where the switch will then make or break the conductor onto the switching line conductor, which in this case is the blue oversleeved with brown, which goes into our live terminal and will operate the lamp.
So we're down at that final light switch, and we can clearly see now the blue conductor has been oversleeved with brown in order to identify it as a switching line conductor. And we can see the brown conductor coming into the common as well. So we can see how twin and CPC cable can be used at switch drops and commonly is in industry. At college, we tend to use twin brown, but be aware that in industry, the likelihood is that you'll be using twin and CPC at switches and identifying it both ends with brown sleeving. Please note as well, the top of the electrical enclosure has had its IP rating confirmed back to IP4X, so object exceeding 1 mm cannot enter. In other words, dust and debris can't fall in. And that's the same for all of them as we go along. Often at college, we can't do that because obviously these boxes are temporarily installed, marked, and the installation removed.